Halloween 2 by Jack Martin. Chapter 9. Karen had to take off her shoes in order to keep from slipping. The therapy room was filling up with steam. It permeated her uniform and condensed in her stockings, rose up to the ceiling, and began to rain back down along the white tiles in rivulets, flowing into mirages under the exercise machine and walking bars. She slogged over to the stainless steel tub. Bud was buoyed back on his elbows. He had a look of absolute spoiled indulgence. She kicked her toes through a puddle, sprinkling his face. His eyelids opened lazily. "Hurry up," he said with a dopey smile. "I don't want to wrinkle my uniform." She hiked up her skirt and skinned off her pantyhose. She stood over him with the shrunken nylons in her hand. Bud dunked his head under the churning surface and came up red as a lobster. "Well," he said. He reached for her ankle. She dodged his hand. She watched him float over one of the jets, his hairy legs lifted, his kneecaps breaking the surface like bald heads. The rosette of his genitals bobbed on the water. "Well?" she said. The steam was rising. Karen held to the rail and tiptoed to the control room. The glass was misted over. Bud stretched out in the tub. He was a pink blur through the window. He said something to her, but his voice was muffled by the double safety panes. With that and the clouds of steam which now enclosed the tub, they would be very much alone even if someone were to walk into this part of the room from the hall, which was not likely at this hour. She stripped and folded her clothing on a shelf under the heating pipes. She set her stethoscope careful on top of the pile. The gauge indicated 104 degrees, the perfect temperature. Back in the tiled area once more, the rumbling of the aerators effectively blocked every sound of the world outside this room. Billows of steam licked invitingly from the sunken tub. She pinned back her hair and descended. The water closed around her neck. Bud's hands were slippery fishes darting over her hips and thighs. Their toes nipped at each other. The changing waterline tilted in front of her and merged with the misty white skyline of the ceramic floor beyond. If the door to the control room had opened and closed, neither of them noticed. Eventually, Bud gripped her more demandingly around the waist and lifted her up to the hot air. A stream of bubbles rolled up her spine. She separated from him. "It's getting hotter in here," she observed.
"That's me," said Bud.
"You wish."
"I know."
He encircled her and nuzzled her chest. She pushed him away again. Her fingers squeegeed his hair. "I'm not kidding, it's too hot." Bud tried to hold her ankles with his in a frog leg lock. Karen tossed her head. "Check it, Bud," she said, using her impersonal nurse's voice.
"That gauge is stuck on 105. It hasn't moved. Nobody can move it. I know. I tried when I got here. It would take King Kong to budge it. It must be wrong. Besides, baby, it's cold out there."
"It can get cold in here."
"Gotcha," said Bud resignedly.
He got out of the tub, deflated. He flat-footed it to the control room. He went inside. It was hot in the glass room, too, though silent as the door closed. Karen was a hazy blur from here. Her clothes were piled neatly under the controls. He smiled.
"Where's your stethoscope, little girl? Lost it again, huh? Old Lady Alves is gonna start taking them out of your paycheck."
He wiped the misty gauge with wet fingers. It read 122 degrees.
"What?" said Bud. "That can't be right."
He touched the knob, drew his hand away, and kissed his fingers. It was hot.
"What the?"
As he stood there massaging his chest hairs into a swirl, the temperature needle crept up another notch, 124 degrees, and inching into the red zone. He grabbed a towel and reached for the valve. A shadow passed over the gauge. He looked up and up. The temperature gauge crept up to 127 degrees, but he could not have seen it. Karen ignored the misty activity in the control room. Bud's arms were jerking in the shadows.
"Yank that thing, big man," she said, turning her back.
"You've got strong hands. I know you can do it." She sat on the edge of the tub and folded her arms under her dipping breasts. The water humped as if boiling. Behind her, the door to the control room opened. She snagged a towel and dabbed her neck and shoulders. She lifted the hair away from her face with her red fingernails. She fanned the steam. It was becoming difficult to breathe.
The back of her neck trickled with perspiration. She dabbed it again. A hand touched her.
Bud, you can forget it. I have to get back to work.
The hand stayed where it was. Her big toe dipped into a mound of aeration. She jerked her foot away.
Ow! That's hotter than ever. Did you even do anything? We sure can't go back in now.
The hand slid around her neck to the hollow of her throat.
You want to go for breakfast later?
She took the hand in her hands and drew it down to her breastbone and closed her eyes. The fingertips brushed her nipple. She sighed.
I'm sorry, I just have to get back, that's all.
Eyes closed, she licked the finger, sucked it. There was no response.
Come on, Bud, don't be this way.
She stopped what she was doing. The fingers were very dirty, filthy. She opened her eyes to the wrist, the arm, to what was behind her. Instantly, she was bent in half and driven forward. Before she hit the water, she wrenched around far enough to see Bud sprawled nude on the tiles of the control room. A stethoscope, her own, nodded across his Adam's apple. Then she was forced down and up and down, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times. Each time she was hauled up by the hair, her face was redder and more blistered until her bubbling, choking screams ceased and there was only the hissing and the patient, silent, curious shadow leaning over her, observing. Finally, it dropped her and left her there, half in and half out, her arms and one leg floating gracefully on the rolling waves. The skin of her face and breast boiled and peeling loose in long, dangling strips. Then the shape stepped over her and moved on, back out into the hospital corridor. It had not been difficult at all. How they changed, Lori thought. There had been a crackling, and then every light in the hall, the hospital, and the world, it seemed, went out all at once. Lori had stopped resisting because hands were no longer forcing her back into the bed. Yet they did not release her.
Hold her! Dr. Mixter's voice.
I'll have a talk with... A rumbling in the walls, an almost sub-audible electric pressure. With Mr. Garrett about this, finished Mrs. Alves.
Just as suddenly, the emergency power returned. Some of the lights in the hall stayed off. The few that reactivated now outlined Mrs. Alves' head so that it appeared much larger than before. She advanced on Lori with an unreal modeling to her features as dim light leaked through her hair. Someone thought of the table lamp. It clicked and clicked uselessly. Only the moonlight through the blinds remained constant. And it was a distant, storybook kind of lighting that hid as much as it revealed.
That's it, said Dr. Mixter, his face huge over the bed. Easy.
His cheeks were hollow and craggy, Lori saw now, his temples scarred with pockmarks. His eyes were black and unreadable under heavy, anthropoid brows. The cold stab of the needle in her vein. That was how it was. But this is supposed to be a hospital, she thought. Returning to the present, the safest place there is. If that's true, why didn't I feel safe when they brought me here, and why don't I feel safe now? That question had been answered a few minutes ago. It was the people, the doctors and nurses. They seemed friendly enough in the beginning, pretending to be interested in my welfare, like mothers and fathers. But that was a lie, too, like all the lies down the years. Oh, they answer your questions as long as you don't ask the really important ones. Then they turn out your lights and tuck you in so tight you can't move and tell you to go to sleep whether you want to or not. If you see things, they tell you it's only a dream. If you dream too much, they tell you not to do that either. Finally, they don't want to listen. They try to make you feel guilty for being afraid. That's the way it has always been for me, as long as I can remember. Nothing has changed. When I was in sixth grade, I thought it would be different. Once I got to junior high. In eighth grade, I could hardly wait to be a freshman in high school. Then I was a sophomore. By the time I was a junior, I knew for sure it was an illusion. I'll never know the answers, at least not enough of them to be safe. Maybe when I'm older, out on my own. Married? No. She put that from her mind, too. Now, when does it seem that I'll know? 21, 30, 40, ever? What a fool I've been waiting. It's like a rainbow. As soon as you get close to the pot of gold, the end moves farther away. It always has. It always will. I wonder if my grandmother knows. She must be in her 60s. I'll bet she doesn't. I wish I could ask her, or at least tell her that it's the same for me, too. Why won't they let me see her? They change the subject like they're embarrassed whenever I bring her up. They won't even tell me her name, as if not knowing the name could make someone less real. I know she's real. I almost remember. Almost. She drifted on a cloud of drugs, leaving her hospital bed behind. She wanted to tell her friends right now, tomorrow, that it was all a game. As soon as she could get out of here, she would. Don't wait any longer, she heard herself yelling in the daylight that would come. Don't put off your life, school or no school. College next year? Sure, if you want to, but don't do it because you think it's going to make you any wiser. Don't use it as an excuse. The time you have is precious. You'll never know more than you do now, I promise. It was as clear to her as the knowledge that she was finally on her own. Completely, from now on, Mom and Dad can come here if they want to. It'll be easier seeing them, but it won't really make any difference. They hadn't been able to help her when she needed them most. There was no reason to assume they ever would again. For the first time in her life, she accepted and embraced her lot. It was like an opening up, not like a loss. I wonder if it would be easier for Annie or Linda if they knew. It's the secret everyone's moving toward discovering all through life. They don't know it. They only know that parents can't do it forever, if they ever did. That's why Annie got Tommy. Linda's got Bob. Now, she wanted to tell them that Tommy and Bob won't be able to help them either. Not in any way that really counts when the time comes that you need help most. Love them for what they are and be grateful for that. But don't expect them to save you. They can't. They're waiting for someone to do the same for them. Don't you get it? Annie and Linda. Her friends' faces drifted in the air over her bed. She could almost hear them as she listened closely enough. Totally insane, Linda was saying, lost in her world of school and partying. Was it only yesterday? We have 3 new cheers to learn in the morning, the game in the afternoon, I get my hair done at 5, and the dances at 8. I'll be totally wiped out. I forgot my chemistry book, Lori heard herself saying. It totally doesn't matter, she wanted to tell herself. So who cares? Linda again. Crazy Linda. I always forget my chemistry book, and my math book, and my English book, and my, let's see, my French book. And oh, who needs books anyways? I don't need books. I always forget all of my books. I mean, it doesn't really matter if you have your books or not. I don't need to tell her that it's a game, Lori realized. She already knows it. Maybe she even knows how bad things can get, like what happened last night. Maybe that's why she's always laughing. And Annie, good, kind, funny Annie. This has not been my night. My clothes are in the wash. I spilled butter down the front of me. I got stuck in a window. Annie, she thought. Annie, you're right. I want to tell you that I know it now, too. It doesn't make any sense. It's crazy, all of it, our lives. You're right. There are things out there, aren't there, Annie? Terrible things coming that we'll never be ready for, no matter how long we wait. We should make a joke out of everything. Bitch to the high heavens. It's the only way to keep from flipping out. I wish I had, she thought. That boy I went out with last month, he told me I talk like a book. And you know what? He was right. And for what? All my studying didn't do me any good tonight. It didn't save me. That funny little man in the trench coat saved me. I don't know why, and I never even knew him. Annie, she thought. Linda, I thought I knew more than you, but I was so wrong. She wanted to tell them that, lying there half awake in the blue dark. Annie and Linda. Lori gave up and drifted away. The bed melted away and she was flying. Over the trees, the housetops of Haddonfield. There was the high school miles below. E building. Mrs. Eddington's junior English class. And there was Lori herself sitting by the window, doodling in her composition book. Dreaming herself out the window, barely listening. Can you see me? Thought Lori, flying over. Can you see what's happened to us? Her own voice rose up to her on the air, as clear and precise as a silver bell. What was she saying? Costain wrote that fate was somehow related only to religion. Where Samuels felt that fate was like a natural element, like earth, air, fire, and water.
She saw herself waiting for the teacher's approval.
"That's right," said the teacher. "Samuel's definitely personified fate. In Samuel's writings, fate is immovable, like a mountain. It stands where man passes away. Fate never changes."
School, she thought, drifting higher. It seems so far away from her now. Elsewhere in town.
"He got in here."
The third grade schoolroom contained exactly what was to be expected. Rows of desks, pictures painted to oversized proportions, with coarse brushes and garish tempera to paper the walls. But as Loomis scrutinized the room, he made out at once the details that set it apart from other Elms rooms at the school. He stepped gingerly to the windows, following the beam of patrolmen's flashlights. He heard Hunt's shoes crunching the floor. Beneath a locked window was a pile of broken glass. The pieces lay like sharp diamonds, reflecting the yellow beam. The knife-like edges of the window pane transformed the lights of the police ears outside into angular red slashes.
"And look over here!"
Up the aisles, the desks were so small. Could Michael Myers ever have fitted behind one of them? Yes. Was this the very same desk? The one with still wet blood dripped on it? The trail of blood led them to a larger desk, the teacher's. A curled drawing signed Randy lay on the desk. There was blood splashed on the paper. The drawing depicted a family outing. The sun took up a third of the paper, sprouting joyous rays. Crooked green crayon lines to indicate grass. A brown dog with a long tongue curving out of its lowered snout. Five human figures, all round heads, with dotted features and stick figure arms and legs. Hands joined, crescent smiles. A large kitchen knife pinned the drawing to the desk, impelling the smallest female character.
"Is that it?" said Hunt impatiently.
"No," said the patrolman, flashlight up.
"Here, up here on the blackboard."
Hunt.
"What's this?"
"It's gibberish." Loomis felt the hairs on the back of his neck rising like quills.
"S-A-M-H-A-I-N," read Hunt. "What is it? Somebody's name? Check and see if there's a Sam Ha-"
"That's not chalk," said Loomis. "Look here. It's written in blood."
"Does the name mean anything to you?"
"It's a Celtic word. Samhain. The Lord of the Dead. The end of summer. The festival of Samhain. October 31st.
"He didn't write that. He couldn't write, could he?"
"Who knows," thought Loomis. "Don't underestimate him," he said.
"Jesus." "How could we now?" said Hunt. "He's killed." Loomis touched the lettering. With a snap, the other half of the blackboard, a map of the old world, rolled up into the ceiling. Hunt and the patrolman jumped, but not Loomis. He was ready for anything at this point. A crunching of glass came from the doorway. A woman's voice.
"Dr. Loomis?"
It was a nurse from the clinic at Smith's Grove. She had been with him in the car last night. Marion, he thought her name was.
"I have to talk to you," she said.
He was instantly ashamed. Why had she come here? To assign blame for the escape? "Go back to your patients," he thought, "and leave me to do the rest of what must be done. Help those who want to be helped."
"I didn't recognize you," he said. His eyes narrowed. "What are you doing here?"
Marion avoided the policeman. Her eyes were fixed and watery, as if she too had not slept since. Her eyes would not release him.
"Privately," she said.
He led her into the school corridor and lit a cigarette for her there next to the lockers. Farther along the corridor, a janitor operated the vacuum cleaner. No, it wasn't a vacuum cleaner, it was a floor waxer, oblivious to what had gone on. Better get in there and whisk away the blood, he thought. Make everything ready for another happy day at school. But be sure to bring everything you've got. It will take more than wax to disinfect this place of the evil that has walked here. He left his mark in stains you may never be rid of. She blew a cone of smoke at a hall fire alarm box and fixed him with her unyielding eyes.
Dr. Rogers sent me down here. He's extremely concerned about you.
The janitor sniffed at the surprising scent of cigarette smoke on the school grounds, shrugged, and resumed his work.
"I'm not the one to be concerned about."
"I'm afraid he doesn't agree with you.
You've been ordered back to Smith's Grove.
Ordered? Loomis smiled mirthlessly. He can't order me.
No, but the governor can. He spoke to Dr. Rogers personally a few hours.
The governor? Well, well.
They're bringing out the big guns, he thought. They wouldn't listen to me when it could have made a difference, and now they're trying to stop me from cleaning up their mess for them. The nurse was not amused.
Dr. Loomis, this thing is all over the state. Your patient escapes once, murders 3 teenagers, you shoot him with a gun, and he escapes again.
That about summed it up. Loomis fingered the lighter, Hunt's lighter. It was useless. He didn't have any more cigarettes, and he surely was not going to ask this messenger girl for one. His skin was prickling with anger. He tried to hold his blood pressure under control. He could not avoid saying it.
If someone had listened to me earlier.
I know, I'm sorry.
So say we all, thought Loomis.
But Dr. Rogers is afraid this could jeopardize our whole rehabilitation program. He doesn't want anyone from the mental health department anywhere near Haddonfield.
Why'd he send you down here, then?
In case you'd already found him, alive.
Tell Dr. Rogers. Tell him you couldn't find me. Tell him anything. I can't leave Haddonfield now.
Marion finally broke her gaze guiltily.
Sam, I'm afraid you don't have a choice. There's a marshal waiting for you outside.
Lori felt the wind ruffling her eyelashes as a bleached white sky rushed by overhead. She put her hand out and cupped the air currents. It was like flying. A man's voice said, I told you we shouldn't have brought her. She was suddenly afraid beyond all reason that she had done something terribly wrong, but she could not figure out what it was. She folded her hands in her lap over her white nightgowns with the little blue flowers and hung her head.
Please don't fight, she said.
The sky continued to fly by outside.
He saw her, said the man. He saw her!
Who was it, Mom? Asked Lori. Why don't you tell me? Why won't you ever tell me anything?
In the front seat of the car, Lori's mother turned around.
I told you, she said. I'm not...
But he saw her, said the man, who was Lori's father.
He was much younger than she remembered. Handsome.
Don't, said Lori.
She was certain now that it was somehow magically her fault. She placed her hands over her ears.
Don't fight, Mom.
I told you, said the woman, changing suddenly.
It was her mother, but Lori clutched the doll tighter.
I told you I'm not your mother.
Her doll's eyes were closed, rust-stained in the corners.
Mikey, she whispered. It's okay, Mikey. Don't cry.
The car jolted. The doll's eyes popped open. Lori whimpered.
Lori,
said another voice. It was near and far away at the same time, in front of her and behind her and above her. Her eyelids fluttered, trying to wake up. They were stuck together.
Hey, Lori, you don't know me very well, but I just wanted to let you know that I'm not going to let anything happen to you, okay? I promise.
Her eyelids unsealed stickily. There was no more sunshine, only moonlight. Blue as the barrel of the gun and the shaking hands of that short, bald man a while ago when it happened. She could still see it.
Lori?
Came the voice again. It was that boy's voice, Jimmy's. She could hear him but not see him. Where was he? She strained to control her head. It sank deeper into the pillow like a stone. She collected breath in her lungs to speak. The air slipped back out. She couldn't hold it, in or out.
Tell Annie, she wanted him to know, and Linda.
They were right, and I was wrong. I know that now. Will you do that for me?
Of course you will. You'd do anything for me, wouldn't you, Jimmy?
Tell Annie and Linda they can come in when they're ready.
Are they ready now? Are they in the hospital? Or did they get hurt too?
Are they in the room next to mine? I want to know. I love them both. They're my best friends. I want to. Then she remembered. Annie. Linda. They were dead. Dead and never coming back. She would never see them. Now she would never be able to tell them anything, ever again. Unseen by Jimmy, a quick tear ran from her eye, along a silvery track on her cheek, and buried itself in her pillow. Her chest contracted. The sob never came. Her breath went out, in, out, out, out. Her skin tingled and everything was blue, and then white,
as she began to lose consciousness. Her eyes remained open. She was not even able to blink them. They began to burn.
Lori, said Jimmy. Can you hear me? Lori! Lori! Are you all right?
His fingertips touched her face. It was the lightest touch she had ever known. She was almost able to feel it. He reached for her wrist, her pulse.
Shit! Said Jimmy.
He dashed out of the room so fast, he knocked over a chair. The door whispered shut on Lori Strode's room, like enormous wings folding over her.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 9 of Halloween 2 by Jack Martin. And Michael is on his spree, finally, and seems like Lori's getting a little bit of those old memories back of her and Mikey. So it's getting to my favorite part of the story, where the realization is finally made, the connection between her and her brother. I know some people don't like that storyline, and they prefer the 2018 version, but I've just always dug the whole sibling storyline, because it made sense that he would want to kill his, you know, to end the bloodline and everything. So I always dug that. So I'm looking forward to that in this story. We're a little over halfway through the book here, and I gotta say, I'm really enjoying it just as much as I enjoyed the novelization of the first Halloween movie. So these have not been hit or miss at all. These have just been really good, in my opinion. But I want to know what you guys think of the book so far. And if you agree with what I'm saying here, that the Halloween novels so far have been really good. We got really into Lori's head tonight in the chapter, and that's something you can't really do with a movie. And that's why I enjoy these novelizations, especially when the author takes the time to really dig into the psyche of these characters and get us into their head a little bit. And it helps us understand them better, sympathize with them better, and stuff like that. I hope they do that more with Michael and with Loomis as the story progresses, because I really dug what Simon Hawke did with Jason back in when we did the narration of Jason Lives. That was a lot of fun. And I'm looking forward to the other Jason novelizations as well from the movies. But yeah, we got a couple deaths tonight, and kill count is at 2 for this upload.
And to cover the kill count, I'm going to let somebody else talk about those deaths.
Yes, it's me. No introduction needed. I want to discuss the 2 kills we had tonight. Bud, strangled by Karen's stethoscope. I guess in that hot room, it's the one time he didn't complain about it being cold to the touch. And Karen, Michael watched her the whole time he killed her. Which proves the old saying wrong. A watched girl does boil.
I believe the saying is a watched pot never boils, but I get it. You just go with your own thing there. Anyways, guys, I hope you enjoyed tonight's upload. As always, it was brought to you by our patrons on the Patreon page. It's Carl Eakins, Catherine McClear, Cecilia Spears, Sean Campbell, Hawaii, Iron Elixir, and Allison Seib. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel. And if anybody else is interested in supporting the channel through Patreon, click the link below. You can do it for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some awesome, awesome rewards and incentives for doing so. And you help the channel keep going and growing so we can keep pumping out all these out-of-print, hard-to-find slasher novels into audiobook form. Till next time, guys. This has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian.
And Freddy!
Saying have a great night, and I'll see you soon.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures, and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker. We kill the flame. Lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? lord. Magnified, sanctified be thy holy name. Vilified, crucified in the human frame. A million candles burning for the love that never came. You want it darker?